Can you hear me okay? Okay, well, it's an honor and a privilege to be here and to share some of my perspectives with you. And I'd like to build upon the previous speaker, Andrea, because I think there are some parallels with what she's attempting to do and some of the parallels which I'm trying to do as well. But I'm also kind of intrigued by the conference title. I think it's, what is it, where do we think we are? I know certainly, so I was here at 1:45 and there are about three people here, so I know that you guys might need some maps to actually direct you to where you think you might be. But conference titles, I think, are very interesting because it does sort of describe some of the dilemmas that that people are having who are attracted to those conferences. And I did an earlier talk at the M25 group early in the year, and I think that was called In It Together. And there's a sort of sense of identity going on here about, you know, who are we? Are we together? Are we not together? And I think it does sort of expose certain sort of issues around a community of practice, really, that you are all engaged in. And one of the sort of images I have are a kind of a like a sort of Wild West sort of caravan. The Indians are out there, and we're going to get our kind of carriages in a row and sort of, you know, protect ourselves, the thing, because we're not quite sure where we're going and who's actually going to grab us sort of next. And I think what I want to do here is to look at where we can maybe together sort of punch holes into that sort of circle, in a sense, and build some bridges. And I occupy quite an interesting position as another central unit. I think you probably all work in central units, called the Educational Development. I'm head of Educational Development. And one of the things I'm kind of aware of is that we occupy this kind of middle ground between being a central unit and all the kind of tensions which exist in central units with other people in the university, but also as an academic unit. So we do teaching, research, educational research into the university itself, and linking out with other projects, other agencies. So we kind of experience a lot of what the kind of systems are at kind of first hand, but also we're trying to promote some of those systems and trying to change the way in which people are working at sort of practice. So similar to Andrea, my role is a sort of mixture of policy and practice. So I've developed the learning teacher strategy for the university, personal tutoring policy, new arrivals policy. Lots of those things are around consultation with colleagues and sort of seeing how far you might get. And I think the question from, was it Dave from Bath, was an interesting one about the sort of appetite for disruption and sort of what are the appetites for change within any institution, really, and how do you get to that and how do you work with people who are changing things and how do you support those people? It always used to be, I remember when I was sort of working with, slightly disruptive way back when, and I had a kind of Moodle server under my desk, and I didn't tell anybody that I was doing this just because I thought my head was going to get chopped off by central services or the faculty of PVCs, whatever. So I suspect those activities still go on. And when I think my role in the university is about trying to capture some of those activities which we know are really working, which are meeting the needs of our students. A little bit what Andrew said, you know, how do we meet the needs of our students to ensure their success? And trying to spotlight those sorts of things and gather kind of case studies. Because a lot of what we do nowadays there's a kind of wicked problems. You know, there aren't really any solutions to these problems. We're just trying to experiment and sort of very much a kind of process of trial and error with these things. So the need to kind of work with yourselves as information professionals, web services, libraries, you know, is actually, I think, increasingly important. George Koo, I don't know if any of you know George Koo, who set up the NESI survey. So it's a similar NSS, similar to the NSS, but it's about student engagement, which we think is probably a much better a sort of metric for student activity. He talks a lot about student engagement, and one of the things he says is about, it takes a whole campus to educate the student. And I think that's absolutely true, and I think one of the things we need to do is to try and think about different models of partnership. And so my focus today is going to be around some of those models of partnership with staff, with students, with faculty, with agencies, etc., but also thinking through the models that might work and with a particular focus on technology. Okay, so as I mentioned before, part of my role is trying to get students to change their practice. And this may be familiar to you, the kind of teaching environment that we send our academics out to teach in. And so we're now in a situation where students are arriving with a backpack of devices, often three devices that come with them. We put them into this room with not very nice equipment, not very nice environment, and we expect them to somehow collaborate together, use technology, crowdsource, whatever they're attempting to do, and they really struggle with it. The pedagogy itself, I think, is really quite interesting because it's kind of still a medieval pedagogy. It's still about, you know, information, a single source of information, which was in medieval times really valuable. There was one book, one lectern, one lecturer, trying to send out this kind of information to many people. The other thing, of course, is the desks are really interesting. These desks are there because of exams. Because exam policy is every student's got to have a single desk because you're not allowed to kind of, you know, cheat, look at other people's. So for the whole year, we are working to a pedagogy which is driven for 2 weeks of the time, which is on an outdated type of assessment. Well, I say outdated. I mean, students write for 3 or 4 hours and they never, ever have to write again like that in their lives. And they're not, totally unused to that. So I think there are some major differences to the type of education we have nowadays. And obviously the single source of information and the way in which you access that information is absolutely key to that change. Information is ubiquitous and extremely it's everywhere. I work with a research group in Australia and get the opportunity to go and teach out there sometimes. And I found this was really interesting. This is their philosophy department, and it sort of, for me, just conjured up what sort of passive students get up to in a lecture where they're not actually engaged in their learning. And this, obviously, this is a hole in the desk. The desk is quite thick, and someone's just been really intent on. Reminds me of The Great Escape, I think, really. The other thing. That I find really interesting about universities is that Andrea this morning, or rather this afternoon, said that we do research really well, and I wouldn't dispute that at all. Somehow with research, we've understood what that means in a digital age. So if you type in your institution and /research, you usually get some really glittering kind of things. You know exactly what's going on in the research. So here's a question for you. What do you think you get if you type in your institution's URL, /teaching or /learning? Nothing. Page not found. Okay. Well, page not found. It's interesting because 80 to 85% of universities, irrespective of whether you're research informed, research led, research intensive, it's more or less the same. 80 to 85% of our income comes in from teaching and learning, and you haven't quite understood how to develop, how to disseminate. What is it? Where are we going with this? We're not alone. Interesting, I looked up Edinburgh NAEPRA, and they had a rather nice sort of Scottish oops there. Harvard, interesting, if you type in /learning, it takes you to their online kind of MOOC environment. So that's what they think about learning there. And one of the things I think about these sorts of environments are not only that, do they not support the ways in which students are learning these days. You go into a lecture theatre, you often find students are not taking notes, but they are taking photographs of the screen, they're recording their people talking, usually not telling them they're recording them anyway. But they are using things in different ways, they're going to their VLE, they're accessing the data there. And there's a sense that we're somehow stuck behind the curve with our students somehow. And we need to kind of change, we need to move on from that. One of the things, this is the same room by the way, but just at a different angle. One of the things we did last year, which really sort of got me on to this journey of partnership, was we changed this whole environment. So it was very, very expensive, as you're all kind of very aware, I'm sure, of the cost of these things. We did two classrooms and a big circulation area. This is also in a World Heritage site at Greenwich. So actually there were some other things which came into play there in terms of architects' drawings and seeking permissions and things like that. It was quite difficult. Actually what we did was we stripped out all the crap in the classroom. So you can see that there's these horrible things in this beautiful environment, these screens and the horrible sort of whiteboard type affairs, and we stripped it all out. Oops, sorry. And the Greenwich Foundation was actually really happy with the way we did that. And we then put in much higher tech spec for students to work in. So these are students now working with, they've each got a screen, you've probably seen these, you've probably got these in your own institutions, the little cubbies you can plug in your devices in, you can bounce your image from, you know, from your iPad, iPhone, laptop onto another screen at the front there with the teacher's screen. You can collaborate with one another, you can flip the classroom in that way. But you know, for a university, this costs us the price of a small London flat to do these, just to do these rooms up. And I think any institution going into this and thinking, well, let's do this, this looks good, obviously is very concerned about the resourcing of that. The other thing which I think I pick up on from Andrea was around the kind of staff development. So I'm predominantly dealing with staff as well as increasingly students, but staff are my kind of main kind of area that the people I work with. And in America it's called faculty development, and one of my colleagues called Mary Scott Cinelli did this work, it's kind of long-term research about, you know, where should we be developing faculty? So she did some research in 2001, and this was where we thought your faculty development in the States thought we should be going in there. So obviously technology features, but there's a whole bunch of other things within that. Okay, this is what's happening in 2001, if you remember back there, Mr. Clippy's on his way out. Cheetah, iTunes has just come in. So actually it felt like it wasn't that far away actually to me. But in 2001, this is where faculty development thought they would travel in. Not necessarily they wanted to travel in, but that's where they thought the trajectory was. So kind of, you know, where do we think we're going? That's where they thought they were going. And they're probably right. I did some work in Nanyang University in Singapore, which is one of the, it's a very interesting university, it's a very modern, young university, but it's already in the top 200, so the second university in Singapore. They franchise an Imperial College's medical degree, but they do it in a totally different way. They work in teams, small teams, from day one for 3 years. They're all given iPads, they all work on the, I don't know if anyone remembers LAMS, as a system learning activity management system. It's sort of born in Australia, but now it's very, very embedded in here. So you're thinking about the sort of digital literacies of both the staff and students here is quite immense, really. The other really interesting thing about this is that when you think about the learning technologists you've got probably in your institution, they've got about 150 students. They've got 25 learning technologists just for supporting 150 students. So it's there's a sense of investment in this, which is massive, which is why I understand they're up there somewhere and probably heading way over the horizon somewhere at some point. So thinking about the sort of digital literacies of staff and how we engage our staff and students in other institutions, our international collaboration is something like 22,000 students. It's very, very big. It's half the university. And one of the things that we've been attempting to deal with over the last couple of years is this new QAA precept, which is around training staff wherever those degrees are offered. So when you think about, you know, your international collaborations, where is the staff development around teaching and learning happening in those institutions? And one of the ways that we've done this is by making our PG Cert online, or it's kind of blended, I suppose. So the PG Cert is every member of staff new to teaching has to do this. It's a year-long course. We're quite successful in it. We have about 70 students. We also offer it elsewhere as well. And we've been developing this for overseas staff. And this year we've got a cohort, for example, of about 20 coming in from Trinidad. And the only way really we can engage them is using kind of webinar software. Obviously our virtual learning environment contains some of the resources and things. But this is proving to be quite interesting because it is about developing that sort of community. They are seeing us, they're seeing one another. They're starting to use some of the technologies which our students are using. And it's modeling a particular practice. So when they teach their students abroad, whether they're flying faculty or whether they're just doing it from their desktop, they can start to have experience in this. So we think it's actually quite a useful model. But when you think about the sort of digital literacy which is going on, and we all struggle, I think, with that. Even, you know, my kids are, you know, 24 and 18. You know, they're struggling with some of the digital literacy now. which is coming up. So I think it's something which we do want some stability in, but also we recognize that this moves, it changes all the time. But there's so many different screens to make sense of just within this Adobe Connect program. For the staff themselves, I mean, we always pair co-teach on these things because someone's trying to work with the conversation, they're trying to give the microphone or the video to a student, we're putting them into different classrooms, so it's really quite complex when you think about the difference of between working in this environment and just standing up in the front and just delivering your notes to somebody. So I think there's kind of an interesting direction and dimension to online learning. And when you think about the student journey, this again I think is really, really very, very complex. So the context I think in which we work in is very interesting to sort of step back and think, well, what is it that people really want and how do we get what they want? So when we think about what students are coming in with, and our universities are incredibly diverse. My university certainly is very, very diverse. They're coming in with all these things and we're trying to kind of work with those students to get them out so they can get those jobs. And it's some sort of coherence around that experience. So it doesn't matter which faculty they're in, they've got that similar sort of experience and it's a good quality, high quality experience as well. So where does kind of technologies come into this? And one of the things we were working on for the last few years was a DISC project, a digital literacy project, which was attempting to make sense of this. And one of the things we started looking at sort of critical moments of transition in these kind of these different dimensions. So if you like, this sort of year one, this year. So that was kind of year one, year two, year three, or level four, level five, level six of an undergraduate degree. And what was quite interesting was that the need for technology changed throughout that transitional period. So in the launchpad into learning, everyone seemed to be focused around feedback and assessment. And Andrew's point about students leaving after Christmas, or I found before Christmas, where we did our research around that, was that they struggle with the assessments. That's when the assessments come up. And either they realize they can't do the assessment, or they can't get onto the systems or systems that work for them, and they say, I can't handle it. They go home, back to mummy and daddy, nice Christmas lunch, and say, actually, I don't think I really want to go back because it's just too difficult. So that's where some of the kind of issues around the technologies come into play, I think, in a major way. This you might know, sort of Maslow's hierarchy of needs, and this is a little kind of humorous view that's that sort of sense of belonging that students feel before anything, they need to get connected, and it's not just a sort of academic program. It's also this is where home is. If I can come onto this university and I can connect up seamlessly from anywhere in the university, whether it's in the cafe area, whether it's my hall of residence, wherever it is, I feel at home. I can connect up with anybody in the in the world. So that sort of the infrastructure that our universities are now producing is so important. So we certainly can't do our job. None of us can do our job without you guys in the background actually supplying some of this stuff. But there's a sense of whether you understand how important this is to our kind of our mission, really, to support our students. £9,000 fees in England, at least, that's making a huge difference to the student experience. We can't afford to lose any students. We're putting a lot of work into converting students at open days into getting them on the courses, and we've now got to make sure we keep them on track. And I don't know if you can read that. This is some work that Helen Beetham, Dave White did around the student experience of the digital student, and you can see that there's lots of, for me, those sort of headlines is all about connectivity. It's very, very important that we understand where this is. But I did think also that's probably quite, that last one is also, that's also quite interesting as well, about what the students, you might provide the infrastructure for them, but do they know how to do it easily? Do they know where to go for that? So coming back to where faculty development think we ought to be heading in 2012, lots of focus on assessment, lots of focus on support. Okay, technology online is there. Where do you think we would be heading? Online bit is really, really big. So I think as faculty developers, we understand this is big for us. is big for our whole community. So if we don't get this right, you know, there is a lot of global competition there. But trying to make sense of what that is and not being totally scared of what's out there is another kind of issue, I think. It's very difficult to kind of second guess, I think, where technology goes, as we all kind of know. And there is a lot of reticence, I think, about institutions investing in a technology which may be here today, but actually, you know, go tomorrow. In fact, John Norton from Oxford tells a kind of a nice joke about a policeman who comes across a drunk under a street light and says, you know, what are you doing here? And the guy says, well, I'm looking for my keys. So he says, well, did you drop them there? He says, no, I just need to see where I'm going, you know, I just need to see what's happening. And there's a sense that we're all kind of working in the dark in this way. And we're relying on some of the sort of trending trajectories, really, to help us. So 2013, I think it was quite interesting that, you know, we were beset by this sort of MOOC phenomenon. This was the big thing. In fact, when my new vice chancellor came a couple of years ago, he said, tell us a little bit about, you know, the institution and what's happening. I said, well, you know, did you know that the president of the University of Virginia has just been sacked because you didn't take our university into a MOOC? At that point, he said, well, what are the big ideas around e-learning then? But I think you'll recognize all that sort of stuff, but it's where do we kind of pick and choose some of that? What do we go with? Again, coming back to John Norton, he talks about, you know, we often overestimate the kind of impact of these kind of short-lived technologies and underestimate the kind of long-term effects and impact of them. So I'll quickly go through these slides. I talked about the sort of fear, and I think in academic life, there is this kind of fear of what's out there, and there's this apocalypse being painted, I think, has been painted for a long time. This is the Michael Barber report about an avalanche is coming. If you're not in the MOOCs, forget about it, you're finished, you know. I also teach postgraduate research students a little sort of teaching course, and often the response is, I don't think there's going to be any work for me. You know, by the time I finish my PhD, universities will disappear because they're so freaked out about some of this stuff. So I think there's a sort of level of anxiety that exists probably for all of us about the institution, about this kind of level of disruption. But I think we are now starting to get over that kind of hype and understand what this area is. I mean, I was so interested in it. I ran a MOOC in consortium with the Open University. We started out with about 1,200 students. We ended up, I think, with about 10 in the end. And it was a really interesting experience. It didn't sell me, I have to say, on MOOCs. But I think there's the post-MOOC environment is very interesting. So you've got people like Hugh Davis in Southampton who are running two-week MOOCs now alongside a course. You know, business models are changing around that. Their archaeology degree, they're thinking, well, they ran a MOOC, it was really successful, maybe we can stop the undergraduate and just work in the forum, do our research and have a MOOC around it. You know, there's sort of interesting sort of things going on, I think, around this environment. Another kind of, you know, that's a tsunami. Now, so again, this is all about context. I'm sure you know this graph, it's the Gartner graph. Thanks to them. But that sort of innovation trigger, you know this graph? Yeah, sure you do, yeah, okay. So, sort of where, you know, all the things which we think have come and gone and whether they've made an impact or not made an impact. And when I show this to colleagues, they sort of think, yeah, I can understand where kind of, you know, information services are coming from that, because they've got to deal with all this kind of stuff which is just hitting them. And academics saying, I want this and I want that and I want this and I want that, without kind of understanding necessarily what the resource implications are or what the kind of the challenge is really for embedding that into a technical ecosystem. And I think, you know, if you look at the BYOD strategy, I think that's an interesting one. Gartner mapped that onto the wave, I think, which is quite interesting. Because the BYOD one is something that's come to us at the moment, but it in itself, I think, can be broken down into lots of different types of BYOD. And if you're thinking about, you know, students coming on with a backpack of devices, I say, you know, what are they actually doing with those devices, and how is that enhancing the learning and the teaching with them? So the trends again, coming back to the trends, the one I really respect is the Horizon trends. I don't know if you know this one, but EDUCOURSE. And when I spoke to the my Vice Chancellor about, you know, ideas for e-learning and whether there's appetite for e-learning within the institution for technology-enhanced learning. He said, yeah, go away and think about that and come back to me. So we did do that. We did a very, very big literature review around that, including this. And we came to some very, very similar sorts of conclusions. That A, it wasn't about so much about the technology, but it was about connecting students together. In Greenwich has been traditionally a widening participation university. We know that 8 out of 10 jobs you get through your networks. We know as well that students at Greenwich often come with through the university, into the university, without any networks, and they leave without the networks. So our whole strategy is based around connecting those students together, and with their staff, and with the alumni, and hopefully with industry as well. So we think that the kind of online hybrid and collaborative learning, social media use in learning, is very much about connecting students together for a particular purpose. So it's about a kind of modern education, as you saw in the kind of room change. It's also about how you're making sense, so the digital literacy of making sense of what that is. When I mean digital literacy, I don't mean just how to kind of read a screen, although that's very important and make sense of it, but also things about how you manage reputation, how you manage your identity, all those things actually employers are saying, we really need employees to understand what that's about, because the last thing we want is to employ graduates who just come in and make a mess of stuff. But the challenges, I think, we're probably quite aware of. So these were the documents, the two documents which we came up with. They're on the website if you want to have a look and refer to them at all, or use it as any sort of evidence for your own strategies. I know some universities struggle to kind of make e-learning an important issue, really. I know that some senior managers don't see it as that important. But the other thing we did was we went around all the faculty, worst schools, we've just gone through another restructure as well. And we asked them what they wanted. And of course, every school wanted something different from it. So, you know, School of Science wanted sort of apps and access to content on devices. School of Architecture wanted Internet of Things. School of Health wanted something just reliable, and you know, where they could put their resources and things. So it was, you know, and we recognize you can't do everything. So part of our project was thinking about the areas that we felt we could make a difference. And convinced the Vice Chancellor that was a good thing to do. And this is kind of what we came up with. So this is a, going back to the sort of partnership model, this is very much thinking through, well, what models of partnership do we need? So we've had the success of the redesign of the room, which could not have been done without that partnership model with Information Library Services, faculty, staff, estates, because this was a room designed for them. This is how, they say, this is how we teach. I've had staff come into that room saying, or other rooms rather, saying, I could not teach what I'm teaching now in this room. So they've got so used to the new style of technology in the room, they can't no longer do their teaching if they're put into a different room, which I think is interesting. You've also got other staff going into that modern room saying, show me another room, I can't teach in here. So lots of challenges there. The three projects we decided to do around this was the kind of the enhancement of the VLE, so to stop it just being used as a repository, try and thinking through what that means. I know that that's, you know, a really rapidly shifting area. Lots of universities are experimenting with kind of social platforms. Now, I think we've taken the view that we probably want to stay with our VLE for a bit longer, but just try and enhance it a little bit more. Student-centered connected learning, which is really about the sort of things that you do in the classroom. So it could be about flipping the classroom. It could be about connecting with employers. It could be about using apps. It could be about anything which is not sort of VLE related. And last is distance learning. And I think this is where, you know, partnership with other agencies and other universities could be very, very important. So we're sort of painfully aware, I think, being a post-92 university, that we weren't part of the kind of Future Learn consortium. You know, I did knock on Mike Sharple's door and said to him, Mike, you know, I understand you're putting this collection together of universities. You know, we do quite a lot around e-learning. Can we be part of this? And it was, sorry, you're not in our club. So all those universities thinking about the industrial strategy of higher education in the UK, what about those universities that are not in the Future Learn Club? What happens to them? So I think that we are, including Oxford, LSE, those sorts of institutions who are not in that, we are thinking of, well, you know, what do we do with this? Is there another space, is an online space that we could actually do, actually even improve upon Future Learn, if you like, to offer those distance learning? And is there an agency around, CISG, you know, who could actually produce a directory of those courses so actually we can promote those courses in interesting ways across the world? The Greenwich Connect came with a very strong governance, and that was the real a real sense of the partnership needs to happen. So I think that you probably hear it quite a lot of the time that the services that you offer may not be the services that academics or students want, but those are services that we're kind of locked into. And one of the things we really wanted to do was try and change that kind of, if you like, the sort of old structure of things, the old discussions that we have across the university. And so we ended up having a series of sort of working groups, each chaired by an academic, and directly reporting to the Vice-Chancellor and also to university committees. But if we were saying things like, you know, well, we really want you to connect to social media and we want to use it in the classroom, but, oh, we don't have social media policy. So, you know, that's putting people at a real, staff and students at a disadvantage to say, what do I do with this? You know, if I'm using Twitter in my class and I happen to see a student who says, I really enjoyed your lecture, where can I get your materials? But the next tweet is, I think I want to go away and kill myself. What does the lecturer kind of do around that? What guidance do they have to kind of support them? So there's a whole bunch of different issues, I think, coming out there, which I think is a partnership between staff across the university. So those are senior staff, those are academic staff teaching on the chalk face, and also ILS, Information Library Services staff. Okay, yeah. So that's what our sort of project gave us. And we started to have some real, I think we've had some real success stories so far. So one of the things that we've started to do is buy in equipment, and we're seed funding different projects. So instead of people sort of trying to work under the radar, we're saying, look, here's some technology, go away and experiment, take a risk of it. And it's difficult, I think, to send that signal to staff who are very worried about their KPIs, the ranking, you know, all this kind of central evaluation that happens all the time. And so these are sort of PR students who use the cameras that we gave them to go out, develop their identity, and start disseminating those identities and some of the feedback. So we started collecting case studies, if you like, to say, look, this is what's happening in PR. Why don't you do it in science? Why don't you do it in history? And we had sort of employers looking at these things, not really understanding that some of these were students. How am I doing for time, by the way?
A few minutes.
A few minutes, okay. We've also, so this is the sort of second project about what happens inside the classrooms. So this is a lecturer whose brother, she teaches math, but her brother's a computer scientist, and she said, you know, I'd really like an app that I could project people's iPads or iPhones onto a single screen. So that's sort of sense of collaborative learning. So he said, yeah, that's fine, I'll write you an app, and apparently he wrote it in about 3 hours. We're now supporting IFA in this work to try and to expose it to the rest of the university and also extend it. You know, not just sort of images, but also text. So she, in this instance, she gets groups of students, she takes about 10 iPads, she gets 6 students working on an iPad, she gives them a problem, and they do the solution, they throw it up. So she can get a sense of what's happening, and other students can get a sense of what's happening there as well. For the last 2 years, or the last 3 years now, we've given all our science students iPads, partly because it's where they come from. The campus is down in Chatham, which, you know, it's one of those areas which is actually has a real issue around social class and inclusion and things like that, and we want to give them a kind of modern experience. But the way in which we had to work with staff, so the iPads became the central thing in lab work and making the bridge into lectures and now into employability, was something which we needed to work with them quite tightly on and promote that. These are some of the sort of ways in which we support our staff around digital literacy. So Gareth, about an Ulster project called Viewpoints, some of you may know, which we found really useful for helping staff to kind of visualize what's happening in their courses. And we've done a similar set of cards for digital literacy, which are freely available. It was a GIST project. And so if you want, you know, if anyone wants to find out, how do I do collaborative learning in a kind of a, using technology? You know, are there things that we can do? Here's a sort of way in which you can work through some of those things. But there's lots and lots of different cards around different ideas there. So some of the things also which are coming into university-wide around building communities of practice around these things, obviously the flipped classroom, which people I think are starting to talk about and get interested in, but not quite sure how to do it yet. That's a real shift. And rather than, so what we're trying to do is to support those staff who are engaged in that, do some case studies around it, try and provide as much support as possible and see if it works. Again, it's sort of that sort of wicked problem around whether it works, whether it doesn't work, and why doesn't it work, more to the point. We think actually our NSS results are probably going to dip here because we don't think students necessarily like this way of working. They might prefer, you know, they're used to being passive in a classroom. You know, that's their school experience. They come into university, they understand how that works. They don't necessarily understand how to be very active in their learners, how to research beforehand, how to work out what they know, what they don't know, and then work actively with other students. But we do think this is probably the moral thing to do in this day and age with our students. And so we've started looking at a university-wide infrastructure to support that. We're having our second attempt at lecture capture this time, but with the flipped classroom we think that's probably quite important. We've been working on a box of broadcasts and with wonderful success in terms of the pilot at least. We've had some really positive reactions, and I think if anything else, you know, if this is how you kind of sell an idea or sell a technology through the academic staff and through the students, that's, for me, that's the kind of way to go. That one. Rather than saying, well, here's the next sort of technology, you know, we probably ought to do this, other people are doing it, and then trying to get students to, students to buy into it. Okay. So if you wanted to have a look at the kind of resources, the case studies, etc., which we've been developing, do go have a look at our website. It's a blog, because it's something we can easily kind of work with and do. And I think I just wanted to leave you, really, the last two slides, with a different sort of model of partnership. So whilst we've been working with staff and with colleagues in the institution to try and make some change, we are aware, as Andrea pointed out, you know, that the student ways of engaging students is something which we realise we probably don't do well enough, and there's an interest in it. And there's a kind of an appetite for it, there's a keenness in it, certainly from the students, who are very, very focused on getting a degree and getting a job out of their degree. And just very kindly funded a project which is setting up a UK national network of change agents. So these are students working to do change in their curriculum. We've just had that accredited by CEDA, so there's a sort of incentive for staff or students actually to learn how to be change agents, to work on a project and then leave the university with some accreditation as well as their degree. And we've also just produced a journal as well, which has been very popular. We've just about to launch the first issue for that, to try and understand what do we mean by change agency? Where does it happen? How does it happen? And one of the things which, this is my last slide, one of the things which I'm very sort of keen on thinking about is where sort of learning design happens in an environment. So this is building on work that I worked with in Australia around learning design called Lanaka Declaration, which is sort of the holy grail of seeing whether we can find a language to describe good learning. Sort of musical metaphors are around there. So if you can, you know, write it down, you can then perform it and play it in lots of other places. But one of the things I'm particularly interested in is the way in which your change agency might actually take place around technology enhanced. So for example, if there's ways, and we know that there are sort of tools around, analytical tools around, for gauging what the sort of digital literacy are of staff or of students, and if you can work out what that learning design has got in it as well, so for an example would be, let's say, mobile phones. You want to use mobile phones, okay? You might have staff who are really, you know, they understand how to use mobile phones really well, and those staff might be teaching, let's say, a group of, an example might be health workers who are predominantly, they're usually predominantly from BME. They predominantly have to struggle with the computer because the computer is usually used by their kids at home, so they struggle to get on it. And if you introduce a mobile environment into that classroom, they might struggle with that. On the other hand, you might have students who are really good at mobile devices. They understand how it works, and actually staff who just don't know anything about it. So you've got an opportunity, really, for students to act as change agents with staff to work out how do we develop this? How do we integrate some of the technologies which we think are going to be useful for your learning in our learning designs and in the institution? So I think just to sort of finish off, the sense of partnership, I think, abounds. In my mind, it abounds. I think that there's partnership that ought to happen everywhere. It certainly should happen between us and us and you, if you like, sort of educational development and faculty and information learning systems, without trying to sort of break down some of the barriers which exist, because I think, again, we are on to the same trajectory, but also taking into account where students are and the way in which students can come in and have a big impact on us. Things like Summer of Innovation, for example, students designing their own kind of technologies because there are things which are missing from them. Those, I think, are really, really very, very important aspects of higher education today. So thank you very much for listening.
Hi, Neil Bickerstaff from the University of Liverpool. I noticed that you said that you were doing some things in the lab. Can you just talk about what some of those ideas might be? Because I'm particularly interested in that part.
Yeah, so this was, we started 3 years ago now, thinking about introducing iPads into science. And it was quite a small group, so I think there were about 80 students that come in, so actually we could kind of manage it. And one of the things that we were aware of was that students had been using lab books, sort of written lab books. And we just had a sort of sense that this was, if you think about the sort of pharmaceutical companies and medical companies which students often go out into, or chemistry labs, things like that, they will be modernizing at some point and using different types of technologies to record. So lab books, like probably books, if you like, are kind of a slightly outdated technology. So we decided to rather than just giving students an iPad, we thought we would very focus it on just iPads in the lab. So we did quite a lot of work around different apps for recording experiments, obviously taking photographs of your experiment. The audio was very, very important. Thinking how they might use those, so thinking about the sleeves that the iPads would have to go in so they didn't have any contamination within the lab. And then really keeping our fingers crossed that the school would find the money the next year to provide the next group of students, because the last thing you want in terms of student experience is to give them all a nice shiny iPad and then at the end of the year say, thanks very much, we'll take that back. Here's an old-fashioned kind of notepad for you to carry on working in the lab with. And what we didn't make the connection with was the way in which they were using those in the lecture theatre. So of course, what students were doing were starting to use this device in the labs. So they had this kind of a tool, and then they were having the tool to kind of think about the intellectual endeavor, really. And they started to make those connections themselves. The other thing that we did with our students as change agents, so we employed 4 students to lead the students and the staff actually around that. So they would do sort of app of the week. They would have a kind of help desk where they were supporting students who had problems with that, actually more staff who had problems with that. And this, the last year of that project, we're thinking about the employability of iPads. So we've gone from sort of lab-based work, iPads in the lab, iPads in lectures, and now iPads for employability. So those are things around maybe making a blog or using your iPad to make a blog, things about recording your ideas, a whole bunch of different things. Does that answer your question? Yeah.
Sorry, did it mean that you also had to think about your Wi-Fi provision?
Yeah, we brought ILS into that very, very early on. In fact, it was one of the project leader, I think, is probably here. And that became a project, and we had to put in a lot more Wi-Fi into that. Yeah. But yeah, that's where that sort of, yeah, absolutely, we need to, yeah, link up very much with that.
Thanks, Simon. Colin Addy, independent consultant. It's slightly tangential to one of the points you were making, but it might be of interest to the audience, I think. Student analytics or learning analytics, where do you think that fits in the university supporting structure? It's sometimes it's sort of absorbed and managed by people like the registry, which doesn't strike me necessarily as the right place. Other times it's faculty based, but by and large we don't really know what to do with it.
We find ourselves in the same position. We say we've got to deal with this, but actually where we, how we deal with it is very difficult. We have, I know Nottingham Trent do quite a lot of interesting things around student analytics. We've had a couple of people in our computing, on our computing degrees, who have done some very, very interesting work around a student dashboard. And they've now done, they've got the data for about 3 years, which is now able to predict from, I think, after about a month, whether that's, you know, at what point that student might leave, what grade that student will get. So but obviously what we're keen on doing is working out what makes a successful student then. So if you can capture that data about, well, these are all the things that a successful student does to get, you know, so they won't leave, so they get a first class degree, for example. So this is the number of times they go to the library, this is the number of times they go into their VLE and they download stuff, things like that. If we can capture that data, I think we can work with students in a much better way, rather than kind of using it as a kind of punitive stick, if you like, for students or for staff. But I think there are obviously kind of, there are concerns, I think, about the way in which we use the kind of data and things like course evaluations. I think those are, you know, the Vice Chancellor and the Deputy Vice Chancellor love this kind of you know, speedometer sort of thing, saying, well, I want everything in the green, and without necessarily understanding what goes on actually in the classroom. You know, things like, you know, if a member of staff is in teaching in one of those classrooms and trying to do some really interesting things, but actually students give it a bad kind of result because, you know, well, it didn't kind of work, you know, and it's not the teacher's fault that it didn't work. You know, it's the university's fault that it didn't work, and yet that teacher might be marked down. And this is Deputy Vice Chancellor's looking at the analytics saying, that's not good. You know, that member of staff has dropped down considerably this year. You know, what's going on there? So I think there's a kind of awareness that we need to be very careful and treat those very carefully.
Thank you.